issues with empires,
Okay, so I'm going to move to much bigger scales, the climate system, just like the GIF. The code I'm going to show you is also publicly available, but it's millions and millions of lines, so it's not for the faint of heart. And I want to talk about capturing paleoclimate changes, in particular, just zero in on tropical Africa. Because in tropical Africa, you have times like this year, in the 1960s, and then 1980, when you had severe drought in the Sahel region, it was very devastating for the people of the Sahel. And then you had times like this in the past, 7,000 years ago, where we can reconstruct what the lakes look like. And Lake Chad, which is relatively small now, was this huge lake. They look at shorelines, they use landscape imagery. So we have these contrasting periods here in terms of water. And water, rather than temperature, is what's going to be of concern in the future, too much or too little. For those of you not familiar with the Sahel region, on the top there is a time series of Sahel precipitation since 1900. It's kind of the anomalies in precipitation. Sahel is a very monsoonal region. They get most of their precipitation from about June to September or October. And so if they don't get precipitation in one year, it's hugely detrimental to the agriculture. And then if you get these time periods like we had in the 70s and 80s where they had decades of drought, it's really an extreme condition. So our indications, you can see it a little bit on the precipitation record here that extends to 2013, but also in terms of photographs and satellite observations that suggest that there's an increase in seasonal greenness since the 1980s. The cause is still debated, controversial. Some would still say, you know, they've improved their agricultural practices and that has led to some greening, and there is some evidence of that. But we've also had increased in greenhouse gases since then. And there's both the direct effect right on the land surface, but also the indirect of warming the sea surface temperatures nearby. So climate models let us kind of look at some of these effects here. And in particular, there's a lot of emphasis on how precipitation will change in the future in the Sahel and really all of Africa. But of course, we don't have data for the future. Maybe that's an advantage to modeling future climate change. So we can use the past to decide. It gives a perspective of how it might change in terms of looking at the mechanisms, evaluating our models. And we can use the past, and particularly I'm going to talk about kind of these glacial, interglacial changes from wetter and greener to drier periods than today, and what processes influence that change. And also how abruptly could it change from a humid period to a dry period or vice versa. And so just to, for those of you not familiar with the geologic climate record, this shows for core in Africa, maybe I'll use this, might be easier. And we're looking from 120,000 years ago to present, and they have records here off of marine cores that measure transport both by the pluvial system but also the aeolian of particles. In this case, they were measuring grain size off Western Africa. And so what they see as they look through this core, they have these periods in brown here where they have wetter conditions and then drier in between. And the wetter conditions correlate quite well with what we know about precessional forcing of insulation changes over the northern hemisphere, and in particular over North Africa, so that when you have, maybe I shouldn't use this, higher insulation in the summer months here, you have wetter conditions in Africa. But you can see there's a lot of noise there. There's a lot else happening besides that. And if you look at a record here, this is a record of sea surface temperatures in the North Atlantic, in this case off Portugal, that show periods of warmer conditions or cooler conditions. And these kind of noisier conditions, these millennial type variations, correspond to these colder events in the North Atlantic, so we get drier during those colder events. And models have tried to reproduce this. This is some results from a relatively simple model, climate, it's an atmosphere, ocean, vegetation model, where they give it the orbital changes, and what they find is, if you look at the Sahel region here, from about 10 to 20 north, they see these variations in the dashed line here in precipitation that correspond to those increased summer insulation over North Africa. And they also see that they have, in particular, more trees growing when they have this greater precipitation. So they have a greening of the Sahel. Sahel doesn't quite get trees, but it does get more grasslands. So they're able to reproduce this pattern of a greener, wetter Sahel and Sahara just by giving the model these insulation changes. But we also, as I mentioned, have these periods where we see these drier periods on millennial time scales. And that has also been modeled. Here is another set of records off of Western Africa, in fact, off the Senegal River mouth. And if they measure kind of the ratios of aluminum and iron to silica, and from that, can come up with whether it's wetter or drier, so or more humid going up or drier going down. And what they find is when it's drier, it corresponds to what we call Heinrich events, where we have ice caps of debris in the North Atlantic that suggests a lot of icebergs are going out into the North Atlantic from the ice sheets over North America and Europe, melting and cooling the North Atlantic and then making region North Africa drier. I should comment on a lot of these figures, geologists still have time going the wrong way. So this is 60,000 years on your right here, going to present on your left. And I'm a climatologist by training, so when I show you some of the figures from our model, I'll point out that they go left to right. But in any case, just look at the arrows here. So what the modelers have found is that when they add meltwater to the North Atlantic, that cools the North Atlantic, it shifts the intertropical convergence zone, the tropical rainforest belt south, and you get drying here in these regions of North Africa where this core is measuring. And just for those of you that don't speak the jargon of geologists, particularly geologists, LGM is mass glacial maximum, so about 21,000 years ago. And Holocene is this time period that started just after about 12,000 years ago. We're still in the Holocene. And most of what I'm going to show you now from our results are showing you results starting at the last glacial maximum and going partway, so just the beginning of the Holocene. And in particular, I'm going to show you results that have to do with the first part of what's called the African humid period. So it's the period from about 15,000 years ago to about 5,000 years ago, and there's lots of evidence that Sahel, the Sahara, had more vegetation, the lakes were higher. And so that's what I'm showing you here in this next slide. Now we're zeroing in here from 20,000 to zero, and each of these figures are suggesting less rainfall and then higher rainfall as you go vertically. So if we look first at a record here, it's kind of an iconic record produced by Peter Domenico. It's a measure of dust in the Marine Corps, just off of West Africa, where the scale here is reversed, so it's less dusty here during the African humid period, more dusty before and after. And you can see the strong correlation again with the insulation. In this case, plotted here is the June 21st insulation at 30 north. So you see this here, less summer insulation peaking here, so greater solar warming here of North Africa at about 11 or 10, and then coming back to present day. And what we have found, that there are a number of alleged geologists have found, that also in the Northern Hemisphere suggest much better conditions. This is from the COMAP data where they looked at lake levels at 6,000 years ago, so during this African humid period, and you see all these pressing signs that say the lakes were much higher than present. What is a puzzle, and it's something that kind of intrigued me when I started working on this project with my colleagues who are geologists, is we also see here higher lake levels here in the Southern Hemisphere. And in particular, this record here from Lake Tanganyika, which is this blue diamond here, also shows this African humid period, so dry, and then about 15,000 years ago, getting much wetter, and then drying out again. In this case, they do sediment cores in this lake, and they measure deuterium of leaf wax, so the vegetation that's growing around the lake. And this is a puzzle because what we know about the orbital cycles is it should be out of phase here. This should be drier during this African humid period because the northern and southern hemisphere are out of phase with this cycle. And you can see this somewhat if you look at it. Now, from now on, time is going left to right. Okay, so you can see this if you look at the insulation here, going from the last glacial maximum to 11,000 years ago, is again at 20 north. Here's that 10 degrees south during their summers, so they get less summer insulation. So we should have a weaker monsoon south of the equator, stronger north of the equator. So what else is happening? This was part of a project we did called TRACE, where we simulated from 21,000 to present. And in addition to the orbital forcing, we also have the greenhouse gases changing here. So the blue line here is carbon dioxide. It increased from about 185, 190 parts per million, stayed like that to about 17,000 years ago, and then rose up to almost present day, 270 parts per million, pre-industrial. Methane also, with a few more wiggles, increased from its low glacial values to its value 11,000 years ago. And then the final piece of forcing that one needs to think about is we had large ice sheets over North America, and we had large ice sheets over Fendoscandia. So these ice sheets were melting as the climate warmed, with that meltwater going into the North Atlantic. Also, Antarctica had more ice, there's some going into the southern. There's a lot of unknowns about that, so this is just the scenario we used in our simulations. We start adding meltwater at 19,000 years ago, and quite a bit goes into the North Atlantic to about 15, and then again at this time period about 12,000 years ago. So just remember that for later on. So the model we used, like I said, has millions of lines of code. The version we used is, I would say, one and a half versions before what you'll hear about tomorrow from Jean-François Lamarck. It's called the Community Climate System Model 3. That's an atmosphere model with about a 4-degree lat-long resolution. We include a land model and predict the vegetation as a full ocean model and a full sea ice model. And it's kind of important when you're modeling these climate changes to have all these interactive components to understand the system. And I should say, to run the model from 22,000 to present took about 14 million core hours on a supercomputer that the Department of Energy has down in Oak Ridge. So it's a huge effort to do this. It can't be done on my Macintosh. And what I'm going to show you then are three simulations that we did. One where we included all these four things to see if how well the model does in comparison with the data, and then to drill down a little bit on the individual forcings. We ran two runs, one with orbital only and one with greenhouse gas only, starting at 17,000 years ago. So, as I said, we first have to see if it even works, and so what we're comparing here to is from the second to the bottom panel is a number of proxy data that we have for Africa in black and blue, and our simulation in red. And so first looking at some records of what was happening in North Africa, the top one is, the second panel is again that humidity index that I showed you earlier. Now just looking for the shorter time period. And the bottom one here is the dust measurements of Peter Domenico. And so we compare to precipitation simulated by the model in red, or the total leaf area index in this third panel. And you can see the model does fairly well. Both show kind of dry conditions, maybe a little bit drier here, about 18,000 to 15,000 years ago, and then getting abruptly much more wet or more moisture available at about just after 15,000 years ago and staying wet. We can also look at the Lake Tanganyika record and also a Lake Chala record in terms of what was happening in Southeast Equatorial Africa, or this region is often called the African Great Lakes region. And again, you see that both the model and data suggest this kind of dry, getting a bit drier, but then getting much wetter here right about 15,000 years ago. And the third is just another record from the Congo Basin. And okay, later on, just kind of, this is a measure of what the Atlantic Ocean overturning circulation that conveyor belt is doing. And you can see here that the response here to that meltwater that we put in the North Atlantic, where basically that circulation becomes very sluggish and then recovers right at the beginning of the African summer period. So, to kind of look a little bit more broadly than just that data, what we did is, for a number of records compiled by the geologists who have collaborated with, they have things like lake levels, they have pollen that they retrieved from cores, they have the geochemical indicators, and they compiled those records where they had a record that went from 22,000 to 10,000, and those are plotted here. And what we did is look at the empirical EOF pattern, try to look at the modes of variability and what are dominant modes of variability. We used, for the model, decadal means, so that we're not looking at interannual, we're trying to look at the longer temporal. So what you see in both the data on the top and then the model results on the bottom is kind of this pan-African weather conditions in both, over all of Africa, except maybe right here in kind of the southeast part of southern Africa. But pretty much weather everywhere in Africa. And if we look at the time series of those EOS patterns, what you see is kind of this, in both model and data, this drier conditions here, from 21 or 20 to 17,000 years, and an increase in precipitation or moisture until the end, with kind of this small kind of retreat there in this time period we call the Younger Dryas. So both are showing this kind of same pattern of moisture increase. And we wanted to kind of understand that better by zeroing in on two regions, one kind of in northern Africa and one here over the Great Lakes region, and comparing kind of that dry period of 17,000 years ago to the wetter at 11,000 years ago. So what we find is, these are model results, I should say, and what's plotted here is on the left panel is Northern Hemisphere summer. North Africa, most of the precipitation, as I told you, occurs from about June to September. And then on the right is Southern Hemisphere summer, because again, the monsoonal nature of the rainfall means that most of the rainfall there occurs from about October to March. And so what you see first when we include all the four seasons is that we have this broad region of wetter conditions, the blue and green here, at 11,000 years ago as compared to 17,000 years ago, that extends across North Africa into Arabia and into India. And during the southern hemisphere summer, similarly, it's much wetter, extending over all of Africa. So we have increases in rainfall in both. If we look at the bottom two panels where we only include the orbital variations now, you can see what we kind of expected from what we know about the precessional cycle. In terms of North Africa, you get this increase in precipitation. That's weak. Here over the Sahel and Southern Sahara, and actually not only an increase, but kind of a broadening of the rain belt. While if we look in the southern hemisphere here, we see actually decreases. So the orbit in the southern hemisphere, as we expected, wants to not enhance precipitation, which disagrees with the data. On the other hand, if we look at our simulation where we have only the greenhouse gases changing, now we find that in both regions, and now look at these middle panels here, we get an increase in precipitation. So it's actually the greenhouse gases that are giving us this coherent response both north and south of the equator. Just looking at the time series rather than the two snapshot differences, what's shown here is the change in precipitation simulated by the model from 22 to 11,000 years ago, where the green here is the orbital-only run. So you can see that for the Sahel in North Africa, orbital is starts increasing precipitation here at about 17,000 years ago, while again over the Great Lakes in Southeast Equatorial, we actually have no change due to orbital. If you look at the blue curve, you can see that over the Sahel region, it also contributes, not quite as much, maybe about 40% of the increase, but it's the only thing that's causing the increase here in Southeast Equatorial Africa. But what's interesting then is to look at the red curve, which is all the forces. And in that case, although the orbital greenhouse in the Sahel, the greenhouse can explain kind of why we have an African humid period, the onset of it really is explained by something else. We got a very abrupt increase in both regions. And so we can explain that if we look at the second mode of variability in the data and in the models. The data is a little messy, but you can kind of see here we have kind of these coherency between what's happening here in North Africa and what's happening here over the Great Lakes region. It's much more easily visible in the model data, as I like to tell my data friends, we can give you four-dimensional data at evenly spaced points. May not be correct all the time, though. But of course, the data also has some interpretation in it. But in any case, what you see here in the model, if we look at the second mode of variability, is we have these coherent changes between northern Africa and the Great Lakes region here. But we have out of phase relationships as we look across the equator along the west coast of tropical Africa. Okay. And so we can look at the time series then, and we can see that we have this pattern where we have these positive and negative, where we have go to the opposite sign here at about 17,000 years ago, and then this rapid recovery, and then again at about 12,000 years ago. And I'll just tell you in the interest of time that this is correlated to the meltwater in the North Atlantic that we added and the slowdown of that thermal haline circulation. So that when it slows down, the, like in previous modeling results, we find the shift of the tropical rain belt south, so we get drying conditions north and wetter south, and then when it restarts, it shifts back. And we find that the coherency here that we get actually has to do with the atmosphere and not the ocean. The ocean is too slow to transport that signal around the shape of the form there. So it's the atmosphere that transmits that signal across Europe and leads to this coherency in this response, which I won't show you here in the interest of time. So you just have to take my word for it. So I just want to finish then with kind of, we're excited about the results, but they're not perfect. And like most models, what we find is that although we get greening of the Sahara up here, we don't get as far north as the data people would like. So this shows some reconstructions of how much precipitation the field increased at 6,000 years ago, so about 300, 400, 500 millimeters per year. And not only our model, but none of the models that have participated in the IPCC assessment report can quite get that wet moon or that most moon that we use. So are there land atmosphere feedbacks that maybe we are missing or not representing well? We do include vegetation, but most of the models still have a fairly simple kind of climate envelope type vegetation scheme. The newest model in CESM is going to try to look at ecosystem demography, so it may be that vegetation, if you have it, for instance, the albedo or the transpiration, so it could. Models have suggested if you can get enough vegetation growing, that'll be a positive feedback on precipitation. Soil can affect also the warmth, the amount of precipitation, the evaporation, transpiration. Almost all models still keep soil at present day, which might be okay out to 2100, 2200, but when you're talking about past changes where you've had the vegetation change, you'd expect the soil composition to change. Not so much a feedback, but maybe a reason why we don't match the lake records is an extensive study where they've looked at 1,500 paleohydrology records suggests that a lot of the increase in the lakes started about 9,000 years ago. And there's a time lag until they fill up, so including a good groundwater hydrology scheme could be important. And dust, we're just starting to include that, but with a more vegetated surface, you'd expect greater soil moisture and large lakes, so decreased dust production. There's both positive and negative radiative feedback, but what they have found for modeling in the recent 50 years or so, if they don't include dust, they cannot reproduce the rainfall over northern Africa. So just to end up, my last slide is what I'm showing here is a plot from the last IPCC. It's precipitation scaled by global temperature, so it's percent per degree change in global mean temperature by all the models out at the end of this century. And what you can see is a pattern that looks remarkably similar to what we see during the deglacial period, where you have weather conditions here predicted by the consensus of models in northern Africa into Arabia, and then down here into the Great Lakes region. So we found that these greenhouse gases are important to give our pattern during the deglaciation. It also seems to be the pattern that the models want to produce for the future. And then just that we found that the onset of the African humidity was synchronized to what was happening in the North Atlantic, the overturning that conveyor circulation. So there is a possibility with Greenland melting and changes in the ocean thermal structure that overturning circulation could change, though probably not as dramatically. Just a few caveats. In terms of looking at this, in terms of the future projections, they're laying these land cover changes that would change what the models are projecting into the future. There are changes in terms of aerosols and that are still unknown. And the results I showed you are from one model. So we're excited that it worked out so well. So thank you.
Thank you for a great talk. We'll have one or two questions, and we're going to move into the question after that. So, are there any questions?
You can use EOS to prepare for us to do that on the model data or data.
The data, has very different resolutions, but they try to come up. We try to do it with the same resolution on both. Yeah, actually, I thought of doing South America. There probably isn't as much data, but I think we're getting more and more. We have some really fantastic kind of data from Africa. The other caveat is that South America is a little more difficult. It's got some huge Andes there with a fairly narrow continent at the bottom. So even in South Africa, we didn't trust our results as well. But there has been some work looking at that. And with the simulation, if you're interested, I can give you the reference on that. It is important. Every place is important.
Thank you.
Thank you.